आई वेलकम यू ऑल विथ माई लव एंड रेस्पेक्ट्स. सिक्स्थ सूत्र, पतंजलि इज एक्सप्लेनिंग दैट फाइव मॉडिफिकेशंस ऑफ द माइंड, प्रमाण, विपर्यय, विकल्प, निद्रा, स्मृतयः. द ट्रांसलेशन इज राइट नॉलेज, रॉन्ग नॉलेज, imagination, sleep and memory. These are the five modifications which may lead to suffering or joy, anguish or non-anguish. Please understand, five modifications: right knowledge, wrong knowledge, imagination, sleep and memory. Let us understand one by one. Is a real master. Is a real master. Even in the second level teaching, he is not losing his truth. He might have put the sugar coat, but he is not reducing the strength of the medicine. That is the mastery you need. How much ever you compromise and try to relate with the disciple, the undercurrent, what needs to be transmitted, should continue to happen. Patanjali is doing that job very beautifully. He says, right knowledge. First thing he says, which can lead to suffering or joy, first thing is right knowledge. You may think, right knowledge is also binding. He says, yes, it is binding. Many times, even though it is right knowledge, even then, it's a mind. Even though it's right knowledge, it's a mind. Going beyond right knowledge and wrong knowledge, that is enlightenment. Even the right knowledge is bondage. There is a beautiful story by Ramakrishna. One guy was caught by three thieves in the forest. They robbed him completely. One thief said, "Let us kill him. Why to leave him?" The second guy says, no, what is the need of killing? Unnecessary. Let us tie him in the tree and go away. Third guy, he waits after the other two guys leave. The third thief, he comes near and releases him, says, "All right, I'll show you the way. Go to the nearby village and escape." He leads him to the nearest highway, leaves him. Then that guy who got robbed, he asked the thief, "Even though you are a thief, you helped me. Why don't you come to my house and have a cup of tea?" Thief says, "No, after all, I'm a thief. I can only help you this much. You go on your own. Now I'll go on my path." So these three thieves are the three characters. The first thief who said, "Let us kill him," that is the tamas, inertia energy, the depression energy. The second thief who told, "No, we don't have to kill, let us tie him," that is the restlessness, rajas energy, restlessness, rajoguna. And the third thief who freed him and took him to the nearest highway is sattva, means intelligence, right knowledge. Even though right knowledge liberates you, it is a thief. That is why Patanjali says, Patanjali puts even right knowledge as a modification of your mind. He says these five modifications can lead to suffering or joy. Even if it leads to joy, it is not enlightenment. Please understand, he says only it can lead to suffering or joy. It cannot lead you to enlightenment. It can lead you to only suffering or joy. One thing with the right knowledge, one good thing with the right knowledge is, it's like it can liberate you. It can take you to the space. You can be free once for all. Like the third thief. He takes you and shows you the way, leaves you in the nearby highway, says, "I cannot come further. I'm going on my way. You please go on your own way." He can do that much. Second thing is wrong knowledge. Wrong knowledge, all of us know. Whatever we have. Whatever we have. We don't have to say, no. This is not right knowledge. This is not right knowledge. This is not wrong knowledge. I am not saying to classify whatever we have. It's a simple, straight statement. Whatever we have is nothing but wrong knowledge. Whatever name you may give it, it is wrong knowledge. You can say, when you associate yourself with the mood swings of Pitta, the liver or function, see, your mood swings will be based on your liver function. That is why early morning when you are out of bed, your mood will be different. In the noon, your mood will be different. In the night, your mood will be different. Means, your thought pattern, mood swings are based on your liver functions. Anything which is out of your liver function is wrong knowledge. Please understand, any mood you go through, any knowledge you gain through the mood swings is wrong knowledge. It's like you are drunk. When somebody is drunk, whatever he sees is wrong knowledge. A small story. One guy is teaching his own son how to drink moderately. He thought, if I don't teach, his friends will teach him. If I teach, at least I can say where to stop. At least he will be in control. So he continues the class. After some time, the son asks, Father, when should I stop taking? When should I stop taking alcohol? Father says, see at the opposite table, four people are there. When you see them as eight people, you should stop taking. Son says, Father, no, don't you see, there are only two. So anything based on your pitta, means liver function, is wrong knowledge. See, that is why when you want the food, your feeling idea about food is different. After you finished eating, suddenly your mood, your idea about food is different. Same way with the lust. When you want the experience, your idea about the other person, your idea about the beauty, your idea about lust, everything is different. When you are finished, suddenly the idea about the other person, idea about the lust, idea about the act, everything is different. So knowledge based on your body hormones, same way taste, food, or physical touch, or anything, before having, your idea is different. After having, idea is different. It just changes. So anything based on the hormone, the pitta, is wrong knowledge. It is wrong knowledge. But people enjoy wrong knowledge. Please understand, really. They enjoy wrong knowledge. They don't want to be the right knowledge. Because the right knowledge sometimes hurts you. It constantly reminding you to get enlightened. It's like a constant nagging. Get enlightened, get enlightened, get enlightened. You just want to switch it off. That is why so much of alcohol, understand, so much of alcohol in the humanity, well, you know, right knowledge awakens spiritual seeking in you, which is very costly. Your whole life will be different. You have to enter into a new zone, new space, which is risky. You may not know about that new zone. So you want to be in your old cozy field. You say, no, forget about it. This house is enough, this wife is enough, this car is enough, this office is enough, let me run. You are afraid to enter into that zone of seeking, because seeking is such, it will just take away your whole life. It is internal tsunami. It just changes you. Nothing else is required. You are new. You are washed. You are fresh. Whatever needs to be taken away from you, leaves you. Only whatever needs to be left, is left. It's a very powerful internal tsunami. When you are afraid of that, the right knowledge means reality always leads you to seeking. In the world, there are only two categories. One, seekers. Another one, people who are addicted. That's all. You can't be between. Either you have to be a seeker or you have to be addicted. Because you have to escape from the right knowledge. You have to put that off. You have to switch it off. You have to divert yourself. You can't be constantly in the right knowledge. Because right knowledge constantly asks you to seek further, seek further, seek further. It doesn't let you rest. So seeking does not let you rest. That is why all over the world, why do you think all over the world in all cultures, alcohol is like a habit. Alcohol is next to food, consumed next to food. Because man wants to be in wrong knowledge. He wants to be in delusion. He wants to be deluded. He wants to be in imagination. He doesn't want right knowledge. He doesn't want to be in reality. How many laws, almost all countries have laws about the alcohol. But no country is able to stop. No country is able to stop. All countries, all cultures, all civilizations, all of them tried to ban alcohol. At least few times they have tried. But the moment they ban through the law, more alcohol is consumed. It becomes a big problem. It becomes a big headache for the government, police, law enforcement departments. Then nothing can be done. They open it. There is only one thing which can liberate human beings from alcohol. That is encouraging spiritual seeking. Just like we have so many insurances, we should create one more insurance. If you are doing spiritual seeking and lose something, they are insured. If a civilization can ensure spiritual seeking, if civilization can give you assurance, be a spiritual seeker, you will not lose anything. Our civilization, society setup is created in that way. In India they tried. In India they tried. And the experiment was really successful. The experiment was really successful. If you are a seeker, you will never lose anything in that society. Anything in that society. In my case, I lived cream of my life is youth. Between 17 to 25, I neither studied nor worked for the society. If I was in any other country, I would have been put in the homeless asylum, homeless shelter, or mad people asylum. They would have put me in all psychotherapy, psychiatry, psychopathy, all kinds of pathies and therapies and deprogramming programs. They would have put all possible medicines and doses on me. But the great civilization, the great society did not do that to me. When I was on my own, when I started seeking, it had sympathy, it had passions, it had compassion. Apart from that, it gave me food, shelter, clothes, everything with respect. Understand? Not saying you are an unwanted guy, but we have to maintain what to do. No. Not with that feeling. How the homeless people are served. The developed countries, how the homeless people are treated. We will give you food. You are an unwanted guy. What to do? We'll give you what you need. At least don't become a criminal. We'll give you what you need. Just keep quiet. Not with that unwanted feeling. No. It's encouraging. Please do it. You are right. You are right. Anywhere, if I am given food without they touching my feet, I am not supposed to accept. And that is the way I lived. Understand? You can't imagine giving food to a homeless guy and touching his feet with respect. Can you imagine? No. You can't imagine. In a developed countries, you will give food and shelter and clothes and whatever needed to a homeless guy and fall at his feet and do namaskar. Offer your respect. Saying you are right, please, you are encouraged, please do what you are doing. No. But the civilization did it. The society did it. When I go around all over the world, I understand. I am surprised. The civilization was built for enlightenment. It is built to create enlightened beings. Many times people ask me, why only in India so many enlightened masters are there? Why they are not spread all over the world? They should have been spread. God should have sent here and there. Why they are all completely concentrated in India? Please understand, it is not an accident. It is an incident. The civilization itself is prepared, trained, created for enlightened masters. Same way, there are many things missing. They don't have an Ainonon, as I told you yesterday. They don't have many things which developed countries have. But they have few things which no other civilization can produce. They have insurance for seekers. The whole society is an insurance for seekers. Whole civilization is insurance for seekers. Billions and billions of rupees are spent in creating infrastructures, basic needs for the seekers who wander all over the country. Billions of dollars is spent by philanthropists. The first philanthropy activity in India is not creating education infrastructure or medical infrastructure. Infrastructure for seekers. That is the first priority. In India, any rich man, see in the developed countries, any rich man, if he is fed up with the money, if he wants to do charity, only when he feds up with the money, he will do charity. When he feds up with the money, and he wants to do charity, the developed countries, he may create an hospital, or he may create a school. But in India, if he is fed up with the money, and if he wants to do charity, first thing will be, he will create a monastery, or a temple. Means infrastructure for seekers. The whole civilization is directed towards enlightenment, towards seeking. So only if you give assurance and respect for seeking, only the civilization which gives assurance and respect for seeking can be liberated from alcohol. If any civilization needs liberation from addiction of alcohol, if it wants to save its citizens from alcohol, the one and only way is encourage seeking. Encourage right knowledge. Lead people towards enlightenment. Lead them towards the conscious growth. Lead them towards super consciousness. That is the one and only way to liberate from alcohol. Till then, alcohol will continue to rule, the addictions will continue to be there, the drugs, the products which gives the kind of the illusory feeling will continue to exist either directly or indirectly, legally or illegally in the society or under the undercover. It will continue to exist because man cannot live without right knowledge or wrong knowledge. Right knowledge always leads to seeking. If that is not encouraged, that is not accepted in the society, if that is not the right track which he can take up, if he is not respected, taken care, if he takes up the right knowledge, naturally what he will do? He has no other option. He has to take the wrong knowledge. He has to take the other side. So any civilization wants to save its citizens, its people from the addiction or products which creates delusions and illusions, The one and only way is encourage right knowledge. Let that civilization think about encouraging seeking. Let that civilization think about supporting the seeking. In India, I have seen every 30 mile, you will have a place for resting and food if you are a seeker. Because I walked length and breadth of India. Maximum I can walk only 30 miles per day. So at rest, I have always found a temple or a monastery where I can rest. I am respected, supported, just because I am a seeker. No other qualification, no ID card is required. In India, there is no social security number. Please understand, but first of all, there is no security. What about social security number? There is no social security number. There is no way to track. There is no way to find out information about you. Nothing exists. The only social security number is this color dress. That's all. You will be surprised. Even in the train, government trains, the government officials who are supposed to take care of whether TTs, ticket checkers, will not ask for a ticket. If you are wearing this cloth, I am giving you some tips to travel in India. Now I am telling you from my experience. If you are with this cloth and sitting, I have never seen any TT asking me ticket. They will ask only one thing, Baba, have you eaten? Means, it's a very respectful word. Baba means father. Oh, father, have you taken food? That's all. I wandered 9 years. 9 years I did yatra, means pilgrimage. So, whole length and breadth of India. Every 30 miles, you have a stoppage. You have a food with respect. That is the main thing. With respect. They touch your feet. That's the first thing. They touch your feet and offer. And they encourage what you are doing. They support what you are doing. They respect what you are doing. So only a civilization which can support seeking, which can encourage seekers. This is one aspect of seeking I am saying. Even otherwise, even when you are living with your family, if the society knows you are a seeker, you have a different position. You have a different place. You have a different respect. That whole society, it is in their blood. So any civilization encourages seeking, supports seekers, will liberate itself from the wrong knowledge and the products which creates delusion. The products which creates delusion. So civilization which encourages right knowledge helps their citizens to go beyond wrong knowledge, to go beyond addictions.
Paramahamsa Nityananda conducts Inner Awakening, a 21-day enlightenment intensive course, and Life Bliss Engineering, a 3-month course for having a yogic body and Vedic mind. Call 919731257960, 919742203311.